Well, everybody, welcome. We have another interview here with a gentleman that has deep roots in the Mitochondrial Disease Network, and his name is Mark Tarnopolsky. And so we're just going to have Mark introduce himself. Mark, how are you connected to the mitochondrial community?
Yeah, sure. I'm the director of the Neuromuscular and Neurometabolic Clinic at McMaster University, and probably the biggest, what we call neurometabolic disease that we would see is mitochondrial disease. And that's how I came to know Blaine and become part of the mito community.
All right, so can you tell us how you became interested in the mitochondrial disease from a research and clinical standpoint?
Yeah, it was a little bit of serendipity hitting you at the right time. So I've always been very interested in exercise personally, very interested in muscle and energy to muscle, which is the mitochondria. That's essentially our furnace. And within the first week of practice, a patient came in who had had a stroke, a seizure, and her lactic acid was up. Lactic acid is very much like smoke from a fire that's not burning properly in a human. And I said, well, it sounds like mitochondrial disease. So I had sent off the genetics, and sure enough, we found a fairly rare mutation. And I thought, this is perfect. It blends neurology with metabolism, with my love of muscle and mitochondria. I think I'm going to dedicate my clinical career to this. And that's pretty much how it got started.
All right. So the next question is in relation to how difficult it is to diagnose mitochondrial disease, and how do you actually diagnose mitochondrial disease?
Yeah, it's a real challenge because the mitochondria are involved in so many disorders. So even obesity, diabetes, and even human aging. So really everybody watching this has mitochondrial disease, which is called human aging. So the problem is that when so many things can affect the mitochondria can look sick. And to say this is a primary or a secondary mitochondrial disease can sometimes be challenging because what we call the biomarkers, like that lactic acid I talked about, can be up if it's primary or secondary. For example, even if you were to hold your breath for a long period of time or be very sick in the intensive care unit, your lactic acid can go up. So we do have biomarkers like that, but as mentioned, they can be from a secondary mitochondrial disease and not a primary genetic disorder, which is what we usually study in the clinic. And that's what our research is focused on. So the challenge there is taking those biomarkers and then doing things like muscle biopsies, genetic testing, and putting it all together with other things like imaging of the brain, MRI scans, exercise testing can all help us to diagnose mitochondrial disease.
That's great. And so there's a question that Blaine kind of has prompted me to ask. And this is something I don't know, so I'm gonna ask this with an inquisitive nature, is that what is the difference between primary and secondary mitochondrial disease? What are those,
right?
What are the differences?
So what I was alluding to, yeah, exactly, is a primary mitochondrial disease is one that's genetic, where the mitochondria are affected. So our mitochondria really are very much like a bacteria that invaded our cell 2 billion years ago. Over many, many millennia, these have stayed inside our cell and have allowed us to take energy and oxygen and to utilize them so that our cells can work. Very important in heart and brain and muscle. And to make a mitochondria, we require genetics, both from our nucleus, which we get from our mom and dad, and a small piece of mitochondrial DNA, which is sort of a vestige from the fact that this used to be a bacteria. And there's about 1,200 genes that make this up. And so analyzing those genes, the ones that make the mitochondria and this little piece of mitochondrial DNA are critical to trying to make the diagnosis. So anything that affects those genes is primary. The mitochondria, as I mentioned, are very sensitive. So sometimes things like muscular dystrophy or other diseases that aren't necessarily mitochondria as their primary etiology can secondarily affect the mitochondria and make them not work properly.
We're going to switch gears here to exercise and the role it plays in mitochondrial health. Can you explain what happens at the cell level of exercise,
sure,
and when we exercise?
Right. So essentially, damage and repair. You have to have pain to gain. Really, to some extent, makes sense even at the cellular level. So what happens is when we exercise and our oxygen levels start to go down, our energy levels go down, there are sensors inside our cells which say, hey, we don't like this. This isn't good for us. So let's find a way to respond to this stressor to make it such that next time when the stressor comes, it's not going to cause as much of an issue. So if I sprint quickly, my ATP or my energy levels will drop, oxygen will drop, and eventually it'll cause me to stop. And then in the recovery phase, all of these signaling pathways will upregulate what we call compensatory responses. And one of the standard ones for endurance activity is to increase your mitochondria. So essentially, our mitochondria, which really is the furnace or engine that we have, can almost double in size after 3 months of endurance exercise training. So it's ready so that next time there's an insult and we start running, hey, it's easier now. I can go further because my mitochondria are healthier. They're more efficient at extracting oxygen and making energy. And really, that's the fundamental premise of endurance exercise training. So it really is the most potent stimulus that we have to increase our mitochondria. So if we think about it, someone like a top sport endurance athlete, Kilian Jornet, who's probably the best endurance runner in the world now, his oxygen consumption would be almost 100 milliliters of oxygen per kilogram per minute, whereas someone with primary mitochondrial disease can be as low as 8 milligrams per kilogram per minute, or milliliters per kilogram per minute. So that ability to extract oxygen is proportionate to our mitochondria, and the more you have, generally, the fitter you are at endurance sports.
From what I understand from what you said is that there is that our cells are continually breaking down, and that we have the opportunity through exercise to expand that capacity. Is that correct?
Yeah. So inside we have it's almost like if you look at my fingers, it's a reticulum of mitochondria that exists inside our muscle and inside every cell in our body. When we exercise, those mitochondria have to increase in size. So it just takes up more space inside. So you have a really efficient, very interconnected network so that if there's energy deficiency, pretty much everywhere within that mitochondria can respond and help to deliver more energy to those cells. And it's a very sophisticated sensing network that senses the energy changes, that senses the alterations in the oxygen delivery, and then ultimately feeds back to what's called our nucleus to increase gene expression, to bring up more mitochondria to respond to the stress.
You yourself have been very much involved with exercise. And mm-hmm. How has exercise shaped your professional career in research and clinical practice?
Well, I guess at a practical level, it's kept me healthy so I can work 12 to 14 to 16 hours a day. So I'm on my 35th year without taking a car to work. So I run or bike or snowshoe or ski to work, and even got in trouble today, if you can believe it. I rode to work and I was going out with my bike, and some person who said, "I'm a safety officer, you're not allowed to ride your bike to work and bring it inside your office." Give me a break. So I couldn't believe it. Anyhow, 35 years, never had an issue till tonight, so it's kind of serendipitous. But as part of it, I think when I exercise, it gives me a clarity of thought, especially first thing in the morning when I finish my exercise. And it also cleanses my mind at the end of the day. And so it allows you to work really hard. So I think professionally, that's one of the issues. Number two, I feel the benefits. I mean, I've raced internationally, I've raced at all sorts of different levels. And you can really feel when your mitochondria are healthy and when your body's in top shape, just that ability to push beyond what you ever thought was possible. And I think when I'm running as well, it also helps me, or skiing, whatever endurance sport I'm doing. I think about my patients, and you know, when my VO2's up over 80 and theirs is down around 8, I think, wow, I wish I could give some of this mitochondria to these people. I wish I can translate what I'm learning about this and apply it to treating my patients. And as a consequence, we've really used exercise for so many of the diseases that we see, both mitochondrial disease, muscular dystrophy, and in the absence of a genetic cure, which we still don't have for these things, it remains our most potent bit of therapy. So as a consequence, much of our research is focused on how we can study the benefits of exercise, understand the molecular adaptations, and apply what we've learned to patients with muscle or mitochondrial disease.